Hi everyone, my name is Larissa. I am a neurobiologist and a person with Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease or CMT. Today, in this gloomy, rainy day in Tokyo, I'm going to tell you about anesthesia and Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease. Imagine the following scenario. You are considering a food correction surgery. There are probably many questions racing through your head, including, is it safe for me to have general anesthesia? Sometimes even doctors cannot answer this question. Even worse, they're hesitant to perform a surgery because they don't want to take on a risk, simply because they don't know if anesthesia is safe for people with CMT. So today I'm going to review studies about anesthesia and CMT, and we will figure out what should we do if we need a surgery and if we have a CMT. Okay, let's go. Generally speaking, anesthesia's goal is to prevent pain signals from traveling from the part of the body that is being intervened into or operated on to the brain, and to stop you from moving the part that is being manipulated. There are different types of anesthesia, some such as general, local and regional, as well as different ways to deliver anesthesia, such as gas inhalation, injections, sprays, creams, etc. During general anesthesia, your consciousness pretty much switches off. And that's one of the reasons people don't usually like to go under. General anesthesia is also considered the most dangerous, although the chances of complications vary depending on age and type of surgery, planned versus emergency. The average chance of dying from general anesthesia is around 1 in 100,000. The rate of post-operative cognitive complications such as delirium is around 10%, but can be as high as 50% in elderly patients. Local and regional anesthesia are considered safer than general anesthesia. The two types, local and general, differ by the size of the numbed area. That is, local anesthesia numbs a smaller area than the regional one, which can numb everything from the waist down, for example. Regional anesthesia can be epidural, which is usually administered during labor and delivery, spinal block, for example, for cesarean deliveries, or peripheral nerve block to numb the nerve which supply a certain part of the body, for example, a hand, a leg, or foot, etc. There are, of course, complications which can arise during regional anesthesia, such as persistent paraplegia or neuropathy, which, of course, we'd like to avoid because we already have a hereditary neuropathy. Among the general populations, the proportion of persistent neurological problems for spinal anesthesia is around 1 to 4 per 10,000 people. And for epidural anesthesia is around 0 to 8 per 10,000 people. So these are not really that small of a number. Given that all kinds of anesthesia are used daily worldwide, it is quite surprising that we still don't know precisely how anesthetic agents work. I can personally attest to that because, you know, when I just started my PhD back in 2015, I was involved in a study that aimed to elucidate the mechanism of action of one of the anesthetic agents called isoflurane. I was doing a rotation in one of the labs at OIST, Okinawa Institute of Science and Technology, and this lab was led by Professor Takahashi, where I was recording neurons of rats while they were being exposed to isoflurane. That's the name of the anesthetic. It was a very challenging project, actually, and I managed to record only 3 neurons during the whole rotation, which lasted 4 months. It's quite a complicated technique, which you need to get used to and so on. So yeah, just 3 neurons. But eventually, Professor Takahashi and his team published a paper in 2020 demonstrating how isoflurane blocks synaptic transmission between neurons. So it blocks the communication between neurons. And if you are interested, you can read the paper itself or the press release explaining the research and its results. Although I did a really tiny part of this project, Professor Takahashi was kind enough to acknowledge my contribution in the acknowledgement section of the publication, which was very kind of him, of course. In addition to this research, I also used such anesthetics as isoflurane, as I already mentioned, as an inhalant, and ketamine as an injectable when I was doing a rotation in another lab and I was using the anesthetics to sedate mice and perform surgeries on them. Anyway, this is just an example to show you that even when it comes to such widely used agents as general anesthetics, their mechanism of action are not completely understood. Nevertheless, there are studies exploring the safety of several anesthetics for people with CMT. I first thought that it would be easier to find information about the safety profile of general versus local or regional anesthesia for people with CMT, but actually the anesthesia types are mixed together in some studies. So the earliest publication that I could find is from 1992. Where the researchers reviewed anesthesia done in 86 patients with CMT. Most of these patients were given anesthesia for orthopedic surgeries, and I assume that's the reason why most people with CMT get surgeries. So in this study, general anesthesia was used in 78 patients, while regional and local anesthesia was used in 18 patients. The patients were given potent inhalation anesthetics and or succinylcholine, a muscle relaxant. Interestingly, muscle relaxants are actually an indispensable element of anesthesia, so the safety of these drugs should also be evaluated for people with CMT. So in this study, complications included 19 patients, that's 22%, who complained of weakness postoperatively, and one unexpected admission to the intensive care unit secondary to post-operative hypotension. And actually, two patients developed pneumonia, one of whom died. No complications occurred as a result of muscle relaxants. The researchers conclude that anesthesia is well tolerated by CMT patients and the complications are relatively minor. Another study was published in 2022, not that long ago, and this one reviewed 52 patients with CMT who received regional anesthesia specifically. The average follow-up in this study was 8 years, so the patients were followed up for 8 years after the surgery. In addition, some patients got EMG electromyogram done before and after the surgery. As a result, the researchers found no evidence of documented neurological complications or an increased risk of nerve injury related to regional anesthesia in CMT patients. They therefore make a conclusion that regional anesthesia is generally safe and is preferred to general anesthesia for people with CMT. It's important to mention that in both studies that I just mentioned, some people with CMT received more than one surgery, but even in those cases, no major complications due to anesthesia were reported. Although these data are quite encouraging, I would say, we should keep in mind the small numbers of patients in both studies. But so far, it seems like people with CMT do not have a higher risk of developing complications due to anesthesia compared to the general public. There are, however, case reports, which means studies on one person, about complications in CMT during anesthesia. For example, in this paper, the researchers describe respiratory paralysis in a patient with CMT1A after rocuronium administration. In fact, this case is very interesting. The patient was a 63-year-old man who underwent a hip surgery after general anesthesia for osteoarthritis. But before the surgery, no one, including the patient himself, knew that he had CMT. So what happened is after the surgery, the man couldn't breathe, and so the doctors put him on mechanical ventilation. After the surgery, a neurological examination was done and revealed impairment in nerve conduction velocity. The genetic testing was also done and confirmed CMT1A. In this case, to induce anesthesia, several drugs were used. Fentanyl, remifentanil, propofol, and rocuronium. Although they all contribute to the anesthetic effect, the conclusion was made that rocuronium is specifically to be blamed for the respiratory dysfunction after the surgery. Rocuronium is a muscle relaxant used to relax the respiratory muscles. So, as you can see, sometimes even 60-something-year-olds don't have a diagnosed CMT and find it out rather accidentally. Importantly, before the surgery, the patient's pulmonary function was tested and indicated a restrictive impairment. That is, the lungs couldn't fully expand in these patients. So, in case you have a surgery scheduled, it's best to inform your doctor about this study and potential risk of respiratory complications due to rock uranium. Perhaps a preoperative pulmonary function test is also a good idea. On the other hand, there are successful case studies reporting successful anesthesia in the same age group of CMT. For example, in this case report, a 63-year-old person with CMT and several comorbidities even, including diabetes and a mild chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, underwent a spinal anesthesia for an orthopedic surgery. In this patient, it was known that he had CMT before the surgery, and because of his respiratory status, a local regional, so a kind of in between local and regional anesthesia was chosen instead of general one, with the use of 5% bupivacaine. No complications occurred during or after the surgery. There is also another case report about a child, this time an 11-year-old girl with CMT, who successfully underwent general anesthesia with isoflurane, the one I mentioned, right, the one I kind of researched, and a tricurium for an orthopedic surgery again. In this paper too, it's mentioned that respiratory problems can occur with repeated administration of neuromuscular blocking agents in patients with CMT. Hence, neuromuscular monitoring is needed for this condition. There are special monitors actually that hospitals should be equipped with in order to be able to do that, in order to be able to do neuromuscular monitoring during the surgery. So now let's summarize everything that I've just mentioned, all the studies that I reviewed. Some anesthetics should probably be avoided by CMT patients, and the one that specifically is mentioned on different websites, for example, including CMTA, is nitrous oxide, which is kind of known for its potential neurotoxicity. The next conclusion is that some people with CMT might have respiratory dysfunction due to possible CMT diaphragm involvement. And so pulmonary function tests should be performed before surgeries. So this is important to bring up with your doctors who are going to perform a surgery on you. In general, different types of anesthesia are safe for people with CMT and seems like they're not riskier than in the general population. However, individual risks should be considered for each person with CMT. So of course I can tell you that, yeah, generally it seems like all kinds of anesthesias are safe for people with CMT, but in each particular case, the group of doctors who are going to perform a surgery on you, the specialist on anesthesia, the surgeon himself, even the nurses and the supporting staff, they should all know that you have CMT, they should have discussed that, and they should probably perform specific tests, for example, to assess your pulmonary function before the surgery. And I would also like to mention that you are probably more susceptible to complications due to anesthesia if you are older, for example, over 60 years old. However, even though I mentioned that there was a successful case of a surgery in a person who was over 60, right? But still, and if you have proximal muscle weaknesses, again, including diaphragmatic weakness, which is manifested by respiratory issues or dysfunction and can be measured before the surgery. Or if you have a rare type of CMT, so that not enough data is available to conclude if anesthesia is safe for you or not. Postscriptum, I would like to say that while I was researching this topic, I realized how complex actually it is in multiple aspects, including the fact that during surgeries, not just one anesthetic agent is used. Oftentimes it's several, plus muscle relaxants, plus agents to reverse the effect of anesthesia. So it's a really complex procedure and should be approached with caution. On the other hand, I don't want to scare you because many people with CMT undergo surgeries, particularly orthopedic operations, for gait correction with no complications and great results. I personally know a few people who underwent surgeries and could not be happier because now they can walk almost normally for like 10 years. The results of a good surgery can last decades. And so the doctors should know that you have CMT, of course, before they operate on you. They should do pre-operative respiratory tests and probably neuromuscular monitoring during the procedure if neuromuscular blocking agents are administered. So please mention that to your doctor, discuss it with them, and let me know how it goes. And of course, the doctors should choose carefully which agents they will use for a surgery for a CMT patients, which anesthetic agents they use. Okay, I hope this video was helpful. Please comment below if you had a surgery, if you are thinking about a surgery, how you went through it, do you think you had any complications due to anesthesia, and so on. Please like this video, subscribe to my channel, share this video. Only these actions, which are nothing for you, but they're everything for me, because I'm trying to grow my channel, and if I grow my channel, I will be able to produce more videos, to share more useful information with you, and hopefully raise awareness about CMT. Okay, bye-bye.